And this is what happened to Horace King.
So they were apprenticed under the master designer of that style of bridge. We know that John Godwin had for years been in construction work. Presumably Horace was trained early because he himself would have only been 16 when this bridge was built. In any case, what we know is that in 1832, John Godwin and Horace King, and Horace King's mother and sister, two combined, seemingly combined families who are, by the way, buried across a simple path in the same cemetery today, came to the Columbus area. They actually lived in what is now Phenix City across the river in Indian country. They came here because they knew how to build bridges. They came with a bridge contract to build what we called the Dillingham Street Bridge, the first bridge for 100 miles north or south across the Chattahoochee.
John Godwin responded to a bid in the newspaper to come to Alabama and build bridges. To the good fortune of the people of Alabama, he brought with him Horace King. And the history of bridge building in the state of Alabama and the state of Georgia has never been the same. They built the first bridge connecting Phenix City, or Cheraw, as it was called at the time, to Columbus, Georgia.
I'm always impressed by the scale of the undertaking that Horace must have done in 1832. He was here, hand tools, mules, 560-foot bridge to construct. That was, he was a young man. He was in his 20s. A bridge that would support the kind of traffic that we have today. Now, he had worked, apparently, in 1823, about 8 years before. He had worked with Ithiel Towne, the inventor of a marvelous new invention, the Towne Lattice Bridge. It consisted of a lattice, seemingly fragile lattice truss along either side of the bridge. You've all seen this if you've seen covered bridges in the South. In 1820, it was a new invention. Horace was involved in this 440-foot bridge in 1823. And then finally, 32, the young man came into his own here and built the bridge that first tied Alabama and Georgia together across the Chattahoochee River and created that entity that is still a coherent area today called the Chattahoochee Valley, the Valley. And this is the spot. When the river is low like it is today, you can still see the old stones that are left over from the original pier of Horace's first bridge, right under the new concrete bridge there. A few feet down from the original covered bridge, Horace later built a railroad bridge, the first one in this area, and the trains are still running over the piers that he built. You see those granite blocks in the water. It's an amazing tribute to the permanence and skill of the man.
Horace King was a self-taught engineer and architect, and he built many wooden crossings across many, many creeks and large rivers, both in Alabama and Georgia and Mississippi, and there's even reports of one in Tennessee. His favorite truss was the Towne Lattice Truss. Now let's take a look at this truss. Towne Lattice Truss, made up of three components. The bottom cord, the lattice, of course it has a top cord, and the tree nails. Towne designed this truss in 1820, and of course the main feature of it is, and what brought him the patent, is the triangle, the strongest geometric figure. Horace King used this truss all of his bridge building career.
All the stories and the newspaper reports and everything indicate that apparently John Godwin did not build bridges. John Godwin built large homes. John Godwin built the first courthouse in Columbus. Actually, it was the second, but built a courthouse in Columbus, the first big one. He built constantly. He was a builder. But the specialty that Horace got into was
the building of large spans. He not only built bridges, but he also built other buildings that required a long span across the roof. And of course, that would include factories and buildings for other public purposes. He's also supposed to have built the self-supporting stair in the Alabama State Capitol, which is the centerpiece of that restored building today.
We know Horace King worked in this building during 1851 or during the 1850 construction. We're not sure that he did the stairs, but information leads us to believe that that was the case. And we suspect that since he was working in the building for the general contractor during that time, it was doubtful that he was doing common framing or running basic trim around the doors and floors around the building. Therefore, we're pretty sure we can make the statement that he actually had something to do with the design and construction of the stairs. They were not just a typical element, they were something unique to this building and unique to this part of Alabama as well.
Now, Daniel Pratt, who was on the committee and probably the key man on the committee, which was in charge of rebuilding the Capitol, was also a designer of spiral stairways. The extant buildings that we know, designed by Daniel Pratt, have stairways very similar to this, although on a smaller scale. So it's also possible that this stairway was a collaborative project between Horace King and Daniel Pratt.
Horace King, as we know, was a master bridge builder. And I'm going to spin a little web, if you might call it that, about my speculation on the way that Horace perhaps built the staircase. Now, first of all, we're standing at the portal of this bridge, which Horace actually built in 1846. And we're standing here, or kneeling here, over the pier foundation, which I'm going to construe as the landing, one of the landings in the staircase. And at the far end of the bridge, the other pier stands, which is another landing in the staircase. And in between, here we have the town lattice, which supports this whole structure over 136 feet. Clear span, no support in the middle whatsoever. Horace was well familiar with this type of construction, and knowing the fact now that Horace actually was paid to build the staircase, we can think of the landing, one of the landings, as being this pier, and another landing in the staircase as being the pier at the far end. And the staircase itself, the spiral staircase itself, being a truss of some nature. Now, between the first landing and the second landing, we have many steps going up, built in a truss-like fashion. We know that Horace was a self-taught architect and engineer. He had the mental capacity to think out many problems. This was a problem project, as well as this site here was a problem project. And Horace was called on many times to solve these type of engineering and architectural problems in his day.
One of the things that was interesting when we had the plaster uncovered from the stairs was you could actually see the skeleton or the body of the support systems for the stairs. They're known as a cantilevered stair system. And the best way to describe a cantilever, of course, would be to think of a diving board where your structure is held at one point and the rest of it is held back in suspension. Typically, a cantilever has about 50% exposed, the other 50% held in check with a masonry wall or some kind of buttressing or columns or something along those lines. Well, when we took ours apart and started seeing how they're put together, not only were the framing elements cantilevered out from the brick wall, they're also known as a radial framing technique. From the very top of the stairs, they fan down in one helix spiral and it's winding down like a corkscrew to the ground. What that effectively does is give you a constant load transfer, or the fact that weight is shifted from one riser to the tread below, to the riser to the tread below, and it just steps all the way down until finally your load transfers on the outer stringer all the way to the masonry floor below. Again, this is the kind of things that told us that it wasn't just a common carpenter that could have built these stairs, and why we think Horace King, who was a former slave, freed because of his exceptional carpentry and engineering skills, and credited with the design and construction of many of Alabama's long-span covered bridges and railroad trestles. Because the techniques exhibited in these stairs parody those that you see in a railroad trestle or a long-span bridge, and that is they use common wood timbers to to transfer the loads so that you could get a suspension or a long span over something without continuous supports.